In this region of Sweden, people have been making steel for over 2,000 years. Back then, it gave the people who lived here new tools, trade, and technology. Today, in this same region, steel is still being made, but now it's used in wind turbines, electric vehicles, and the clean energy transition. But steel makes up around 7 or 8% of global CO2 emissions, and even the clean steel today isn't fully clean. Even electric arc furnaces, which use electricity to melt steel, they still burn fossil fuels for one last step. But this steel plant has figured out how to cut that too. Here at Ovako's Hofors facility, a world-first innovation is eliminating the last fossil fuels from the electric arc furnace by reheating the steel, not with gas, but with hydrogen. Made and burned on site. From ancient forges to hydrogen flames, this is what the future of low-emission steel looks like. I'm Rosie Barnes, an engineer with 20 years' experience developing clean energy technologies and founder of Padlet Consulting, who provide advice to clean tech startups and investors. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. Thousands of years ago, steel gave its earliest users sharper tools, stronger weapons, and more durable infrastructure. Today, it's still a foundation for progress, used to build cities and railways and much of the infrastructure of the energy transition. And this region of Sweden has been at the center of that story for over 2,000 years. Rich deposits of high-quality iron ore, vast forests to supply charcoal for early furnaces, and fast-flowing rivers to power hammers and bellows made it the ideal place to develop a steel industry long before fossil fuels. And this region is blessed with the natural resources that give them a natural advantage for the challenges of today. They're still using the iron ore and abundant water, but now also wind energy to provide clean electricity, which powers hydrogen production and the electric arc furnace. The traditional way of making steel, using a blast furnace, relies on coal and produces nearly 2 tons of CO2 for every ton of steel. One of the main alternatives is the electric arc furnace, or EAF, which uses electricity to melt a feedstock of recycled steel scrap, sometimes mixed with direct reduced iron or pig iron to get the chemistry just right. Oxygen is blown over the molten steel, impurities react with it, and form a slag that's removed. The steel is then cast into semi-finished forms like ingots. Depending on the final product, it may be rolled into bars, rods, or sheets, or undergo additional shaping, heat treatment, or finishing processes. Emissions from electric arc furnaces are much lower than blast furnaces, especially when powered by renewable electricity. And as grids decarbonize, the emissions from EAF steel keep getting better. But even in this cleaner process, there's still one surprising source of emissions: reheating the steel before rolling, which is normally done using gas-fired furnaces that heat the steel to over 1,100 degrees. These furnaces are energy intensive and almost always rely on fossil fuels, even in otherwise low emissions operations. This contributes around 80 to 120 kilograms of CO2 per ton of steel. It's not so much compared to nearly 2 tons emitted from traditional blast furnaces, but it can add as much as 15 to 30% to the footprint of low emissions EAF steel. This is where Ovako's Hofors plants comes in. It's the first in the world to use fossil-free hydrogen to heat steel, making the steel that comes out of this factory the lowest emissions in the world. Let's take a look inside to see how it works. So how does the electric arc furnace work?
You will first lift it out and tilt it outwards. Then the scrap balls inside here, for that we're adding energy, roughly 50,000 kilowatt hours, 5 to 1,000 volts. We have the transformer out here, high current, up to 60,000 amps. Inside the furnace, then we'll be like a welding machine, where the electrodes are almost in contact with the scrap. So then you have an arc that go from the electrode to the scrapper, and that will be melting the scan. The distance between the electrode and the scrap is controlled automatically to see that it'll have the best distance. It's not necessary, but it helps.
And how does it compare to a blast furnace in terms of temperature and emissions?
We are tapping a much higher temperature, roughly 15, 38 degrees Celsius. We need a little more energy because we are adding alloys. The benefit with an arc furnace is we are going from scrap, but the blast furnace is going from one ore. And then you have a lot of iron oxide. Here, I've been needing roughly 25 kilos per ton. And if I go back to my school books, then I think it was roughly 450 kilos in the blast furnace to produce 1 ton of iron. So here to our left, there we have different internal scrap. So we try to keep some of the alloys that we can't reduce with oxygen separated, so we can use them. These are dust collectors. One is from the roof in the arc furnace, and the other one is extracted from the arc furnace. So we are producing roughly 1,700 kilos of dust every heat.
So this is the layout of the steel rolling mill. The steel mill is over here, and the ingot is transported in hot condition to the pit furnaces, which are here. So they will arrive in their molds. We pick them, charge them in the furnace, and heat them up to 1200 degrees. They will arrive like 800-900 degrees warm, and we heat them up to rolling temperature. Then we keep the material or the ingots at rolling temperature for some hours to get the right properties in the material before rolling.
Wow, the radiant heat is really something.
It's 1200 degrees down there. We have in total 48 reheating furnaces here, and we can keep 6 ingots in each furnace. They are heated by liquid petrol or by hydrogen, and we can use either media depending on conditions and the actual price of electricity and price of petrol.
Petrol, the same as what you put in a car?
No, it's LPG, it's propane. So in these two lines, we have two pipes in and the distribution equipment to be able to use both hydrogen or propane. Then we have a really intelligent software choosing the media depending on temperature in the furnace and the availability of hydrogen from the hydrogen production. 10 years ago, we had oil. So we moved from oil to propane oxygen, oxy-fuel, so to say. And then we're now converting to hydrogen or a combination hydrogen and propane. So we have a combi, you can call it a combi system.
So this is the furnace control room, you could say. The pink volumes are heated with hydrogen, and the orange color is then the furnace are heated with propane. And then the system will control which media to use and seamlessly change from propane to hydrogen without us knowing it. We have put an electricity price from where we think it's affordable to run the electrolyzer and produce hydrogen.
So do you pay a cost penalty or do you save money by using the hydrogen?
We can do both, and we can save money, of course, when the electricity price is low. But the limit here is set a little bit more higher, so we pay a little bit extra for using the hydrogen, which we want to do that.
And what is the emissions here compared to normal steel?
Compared to the global average, we are like 80% lower.
And I heard that you've got the world record for the lowest emissions steel.
We had that before, and we will take even further step, being the best in the world, yes.
So the heated ingot will be pushed through a slade and go by a roller conveyor into the rolling mill. It's a reversible mill where the ingot will pass back and forth while we are decreasing the gap between the rollers and also turning the ingot every second pass. We have three different rolling mills to break down the ingot from 600 square down to the size the customer needs, which is a round bar from 80 millimeters to a round bar of 230 millimeters. We also produce some square products. Main products will be further processed in our other facilities like tube mills, ring rolling, and bar peeling machines and so on. But here we produce black bars. So we have different rollers for different sizes. After the rolling, we will cut away the end of the bar through a hot shear, cutting away the top of the ingots to clear it from surface defects and such things. So we cut the bars and then they will end up on the cooling bed. We are marking and grinding the end of the bars to remove some burrs and put the heat number on them.
These are the electrolyzers, 8 stacks of electrolyzers.
And this is how many megawatts of hydrogen?
20. The pit furnaces are like, if we're running them full speed, 17 megawatts. So we have a few megawatts in spare.
Do you do anything with the oxygen?
So we will use the hydrogen for heating, of course, but also the oxygen. And we'll put the oxygen on our district system here to be used in different furnaces. And we will also use the excess heat to put it on the district heating system, heating up some villages around the area.
I usually write a draft outro for these tour videos to save time on the day, and then I tweak it a little bit based on what I saw that day. But today I had to throw my original draft in the bin because while if I haven't got an entirely different perspective on steelmaking and the decarbonisation challenge now, I really hope that I was able to capture the scale of this industry in my footage. I kept thinking as I was walking through the rolling process, this is just like a pasta machine, but incredibly heavy, incredibly hot. The steel bars were being thrown around just like red hot noodles. The weight and the heat that radiates off just make it abundantly clear that this is a totally different challenge to, say, electrifying homes and powering them with solar panels and batteries. But of course, for the most part, the solutions are still the same as in small industry, just scaled up. Then there's the addition of hydrogen, which has no place being used for heating in the home, but makes a lot of sense here. Ovako's approach is full of clever engineering to get around some of the challenging aspects of using hydrogen. They burn it immediately without needing to store or transport it, which are two of the hardest things to do with hydrogen. Plus, their electrolyzer can ramp up and down with the electricity supply, depending on the prices, which helps them to cut costs significantly. And it's retrofittable, which means it can be rolled out fast. So overall, it's an amazing facility here, making the lowest emission steel in the world. I am so grateful to Ovako for giving me the opportunity to film this here, especially since it was like 2 days ago that we even started hatching this plan to come here. It is important to remember though, this approach depends on scrap steel. And while it's a critical part of decarbonizing steel, it's not the whole global solution because global demand for steel is still growing. And that means that scrap alone won't be enough to solve that problem. For some of the other technologies available for zero emissions technology to make virgin iron and steel, you can check out these videos that I've made on the topic. Thanks to the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team who support all my videos, and we have an exclusive Discord server that we use to chat about all things energy. We would love to welcome you to the team. You can join us at the link in the description.